Hello everyone, Dr. Maiden here, and I'm coming to you with a video on how to narrow your research topic. Okay, so paper writing season is officially upon us here at UNF. Most of us are past the midterm point in the semester, and we're looking to, in the case of at least two of my classes, some final papers are happening now. And so I wanted to put out a video here that's looking at how to narrow your research question, how to narrow down your research design. Because typically when I meet with students and they're having questions about this, again, like with a lot of things I post videos about, if you're saying, you know, Dr. Maiden, is this research question too broad? Is this too big of a question, too big of a topic for the paper? My safe answer always and forever is going to be yes. It's too big of a topic. We need to narrow that sucker down. Okay. And this is because of just experience at this point, both me as a student making this mistake, then me going through grad school and continuing to make this mistake, now being a professor, and seeing, goodness gracious, just how often students are making this mistake. We get projects that are way, way, way too big, particularly if you're looking at doing a paper that's only 5 to 7 pages long. Okay, so this is going to walk through a couple of examples, or I'm going to take one example and walk you through a couple ways to think about how to take a project that's this big and scrunch it down into something much more doable for your final paper. All right, so the idea here is that in most cases, your paper needs to answer some kind of question. You are positing a question, and then your thesis statement is an answer to that question. So I'm going to walk through here kind of the narrowing process. We're going to start with just a broad general topic. So maybe you're at a point where you're just trying to think, what do I want to write about? So this is the example I came up with, something like, I'm interested in the impact of democratization on improving education. Okay? That is way too big. Number one, there's no question in there. If you were to come to my office and I'm going to say, what do you want to write a paper about? And you say, oh, I'm really interested on, you know, democracy and education. That's not a question. You're thinking way out here, okay? So we're going to click you in a couple steps and we're going to say, all right, let's reframe this, number one, as a question. We need to get some type of causal relationship in here where we have an independent variable and a dependent variable, right? Independent variable, dependent variable. What is the causal relationship framing this question? So immediately we can say, okay, take I'm interested in democratization and education, frame it as a question with a causal argument put into it. So we could say, does an increase in democracy, that's the independent variable, does an increase in democracy lead to improved education? So education is the dependent variable. It is the thing that is being changed as a result of the independent variable, democracy, improving or not improving. Okay, so if we've got our XY here, X is democracy over time, Y is education. So the expectation here is we're saying, does an increase in democracy, if we're moving this way, does it also increase education? So we're looking for this type of causal relationship, a correlation, both going upwards. Okay? That's the general question. Start there. That's not going to be how we frame out the paper necessarily. Start there and do some research and see if someone has answered that question. Has anyone in the research, go to the library, I'll link down below with the thing on how you can kind of get started, some launch pads you can use for starting your research. Start there and say, okay, has anyone answered that question? That is also a big question to ask. Does democracy improve education? What you will find pretty darn quick is there's a ton of literature on this, a ton that says, yes, rates of democracy do increase improve education. So you have a very clear positive correlation between these two things. So right there, even if you just go to a site like Our World in Data, I perused that a little bit. I found three very strong sources saying, yes, absolutely. There is a relationship, a positive correlation between democracy and education. So right there, you've got the sources that you need to fill out your background section of your paper and say, we know that we see this. We are sure that democracy improves education. But what we're doing with your paper, remember, you've only got 7 pages. You can't give me an opus on all of the myriad ways democracy might improve education. So we're clicking you back in a little bit closer here. Again, something like on the Our World and Data site, there was a really interesting thing saying that, in particular, democracy can improve student-teacher ratios. So the more democratic a country is, the smaller the ratio becomes between student to teacher. So you're not having challenges, you know, in a country like Nigeria, where the student-teacher ratio may be something absurd like 56 students for every one teacher. When you are increasing democratization, a natural result of that is smaller student-teacher ratios. So this is a much, much smaller topic that you can be getting into. This makes sense for a smaller topic for a paper, that you could say, all right, general question, our big picture question is this idea that democracy does improve education. I'll clearly cite that literature in the background section, but what I'm doing is I'm looking specifically at how democratization might be improving this particular thing of student-teacher ratios. So then what you're doing is you're having a much narrower question of what is the impact of democracy on student-teacher ratios. And here, particularly if you're doing something like a comparative politics class, I'm looking at you, people that are in my comparative, intro to comparative class right now, you've got an essay you're supposed to be doing. You could do something really lovely by using something like the Human Development Index data, varieties of democracy data, even something like the Fragile States Index data, Democracy Index 2019, that's through The Economist. All these different data sets where you could be picking a couple of countries and doing a nice comparison. One that I did for an example is, you know, you want to try and hold things constant. I'll do another video on how to do case studies and things like that. But just as an example, I picked 3 countries that, in the one case, I picked Japan, Russia, and Mexico. So we're going to say, we're going to do a comparative analysis of levels of democratization leading to improved student-teacher ratios, and look at these 3 countries as kind of benchmark examples of, in the case of Mexico, they're in the top 100 on the Human Development Index, which is measuring life expectancy, education, purchasing power parity, right? You could compare HDI literature with some other benchmark democracy study, but in this case, Mexico is in the top 100, Russia's in the top 50, Japan's in the top 20, I think even top 15, okay? So what you're doing is saying, let's look across these cases. All else being equal, all 3 of these are mixed proportional representation voting system countries, right? So they do have some similarities in the way that their electoral systems work, which should impact the way that their overall government systems work, and then the degree to which they are democratic within those systems, right? Same type of voting system in place, whether or not they're democratic to the same degree, we can see an impact over time that the more democratic they become, the smaller those student-teacher ratios become. That could be an interesting small paper topic that you could do that is so much more narrowed down, right? We've narrowed it to a couple of countries, we've narrowed it to this specific issue of student-teacher ratios, rather than just saying, I'm interested in, clicking way back out again, I'm interested in democracy and education, okay? So this is just a quick video example to show how we take big ideas and click them down to size for smaller or small to medium sized papers, okay? I could do 100 examples like this. If you have some other topic in mind that you want to talk to me about and say, I want to walk through that same process, walk me through it, Dr. Maiden. We can do that. I'm happy to do that with students so that you can see how to take these big ideas and make them a lot smaller. Narrow your paper idea to the smallest possible thing that you can so that the argument you're making is much more concise and much more to the point and focused. Okay, so let me know if you have any questions. My students, please feel free to reach out to me. Otherwise, get going, get exploring, think about those data projects, and think about how to make them a nice small package neatly tied up with a bow. All right, have a great weekend.